child, things are gonna get easier. Ooh, child, things will get brighter. Ooh, child, things are gonna get easier.
Hi there, fellow SLPs out there. Today, I want to do a little introduction to a podcast interview that I'm about to show you. First, I want to give a little admission about an obsession that I have. And I feel pretty safe in saying, because I know you SLPs out there, probably a lot of other obsessed type people out there, type A type people out there. And I've really, over the last few years, obsessed over language and its importance to brain development, just in general. You know, there's been a lot of studies that have come out that have shown, you know, to talk about the word gap, right? And the more words that children hear early on in life ultimately tells whether they will succeed academically and just life in general, right? So it really, by these studies, makes it seem like that language is one of, if not the most important thing to brain development. And of course, as a language pathologist, I start to think, well, it must be true, right? Language is that important. But I really had to kind of start asking myself, there's got to be somebody who has done some work that has inspected other cultures across the planet and across time who surely have had different ways of approaching raising children. I'm sure there's been cultures that have talked a lot to their children and some that maybe haven't done so almost at all. And so I wanted to know, is this information out there? And so I started doing a little bit of research. I found a fantastic book, and then I found the author. And so the book is called Raising Children, Surprising Insights from Other Cultures. And it really does provide a lot of surprising insights. And the author, his name is David Lancy, and he is an anthropologist. But he's not just any anthropologist, he is a childhood development anthropologist. So these books are fantastic because he doesn't have an agenda as to how to raise your children, like just about every other area of childhood development, right? I suppose his only agenda would be to show us where we stand in the grand scheme of things. And as it happens, our society, he refers to this, our modern Western society, as weird. And he doesn't say this in a derogatory sense. It stands for Western, educated, industrialized, rich, and democratic. And as it turns out, our society is kind of weird. It's a major outlier in the grand scheme of things, where we put our children at the top of the pyramid, and we think that they are the most important things, and that we should give them so much attention, super high on the pyramid, right? And he calls this a neontocracy. So we live in a weird neontocracy, okay? But he contrasts this to other societies throughout time that he refers to kind of in a general sense as the village. And their pyramid at the top would be elders. Elders are highly respected, revered, and children are down at the bottom of the pyramid. So it's in contrast, obviously, to our more weird society. So you'll hear us talk quite a bit about that in the interview. But I just want to talk a little bit about why I think his work is so important. If I could use one word to describe why it's important to understand, get to know his work, I would say the word is balance. Because it really does balance are extremes. I think, you know, pendulums are always swinging, right? And right now, I think our pendulum, we are way up here as far as the focus that we put on our children. And, you know, on the other end of the pendulum is the village. So by us knowing both, it does bring some balance. And, you know, the word balance, I think, is really holds a lot of weight when it comes to humanity, because when things are not balanced, you see the behavior, stark changes in human behavior. You know, if we come to a bridge that is not balanced, how are you going to feel? Anxious, nervous, terrified, uneasy, right? And so, you know, that's a literal sense of the word balance, but metaphorically speaking too, when your life is not balanced, you tend to feel all those things, uneasy, anxious. And, you know, before all this pandemic stuff, every week I met with parents and we did trainings on how they could improve speech and language in their home, okay, to make it a more language-rich environment. But inevitably, almost all the parents, and these are wonderful, well-meaning people who just love their children, they're all anxious. They have this feeling that they're never doing good enough, highly guilty. I'm the parent of three, and certainly I have those feelings and have had them most of my life. And so I got to thinking about all of this. And, you know, through no fault of our own, I think we've ended up on this end of the swinging pendulum. And because we're on one end of this pendulum where it's not balanced, I think we inevitably, even though we don't realize that we're kind of not centered, we still feel uneasy and anxious. And I certainly see this with the parents that I see. And I think that there's a lot that we can take from David's work to make us feel not so uneasy. There's a lot that we can do naturally as parents to where we don't have to feel like we have to be on the ball and always doing an amazing parenting job all the time. Because it's just, you know, it's not possible. So there's a lot to be learned, I think, from the village setting. And you're going to hear some of that in the interview. And if you read his books, you'll learn a lot of that. And that's not to say that the Western society doesn't offer a lot of good things. I do think that there was a time when children were seen and not heard, and we didn't give them enough emotional support. And I think the Western society has been good in that regard, but it's just gone too far in one direction. So hopefully you'll find David as interesting as I have. If you're a parent or an educator, I hope that it will also help you find a balance. The subtitle of our podcast is A Journey Through Modern Day Parenting. And we've certainly done a lot of journeying through modern day stuff on our podcast on previous episodes. David's work allows us to journey through different ages of parenting. And my hope is that we can journey down modern day, and we can journey down past and different, vastly different cultures, and then, you know, pick the fruits from both paths, and then find the middle way. And if we can start traveling down that middle way, certainly we will, hopefully anyway, find a balance. So dive in. I hope you find him as interesting as I have. He's a wonderful guy. Let's get going. Time to chat.
Hi, I'm Tanya Friend, and I've been a speech and language pathologist for 13 years. I am also the owner and director of Chatterbox Speech Therapy, a speech therapy practice that serves the children and community in Albuquerque, New Mexico.
And I'm Corey Walker. I've been working with children for nearly 20 years, and I was a pioneering app developer in the area of speech and language pathology. We all have gifts in this life, and mine is knowing what makes children tick. Parenting in the modern age comes with uncharted challenges. We'll be bringing you discussions with experts in childhood development and introducing some tough questions and topics.
Together with our experience and knowledge, we have created this podcast to help you with your child's development and wellness. So, listen up.
Because it's time to chat. So, if you don't mind, I kind of just start with how I found your books.
Okay.
I was just delighted, and I still am. If you could see all the highlights in the book, there's probably more that's not highlighted. But so since I'm a speech therapist, my focus is big time on language. Mm-hmm. And I recently had come across a lady talking about a study, how the more language that a child hears growing up, mm-hmm. Ultimately, the better they do academically in the long term. But that doesn't include, they did studies, they had control groups and everything where they taught the kids the same exact things over a screen, mm-hmm. And they did not learn compared to the in-person learning. So I just got to really, really thinking about how language impacts oral learning and how I thought there must be somebody who's done some studies on, you know, cultures throughout time. Some cultures probably use a lot of language, some probably use very little. So doing some studying about or some researching into who may have done all this studying into childhood development is how I ran into your book. And then I just ended up learning so much more than just about language, but just about how things have evolved over time. And finding so much, I don't know, it says so much about our culture these days and how we put an emphasis on our children and how it's really an outlier throughout history and even probably in the world today. Would you agree that that's true?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Yes, I wouldn't disagree with a single thing you said so far.
Yeah. Can you just, I don't know. I didn't think that maybe cultures always revered kids as much as we do here in the Western society, but I had no idea how much it was. Some cultures didn't even view babies as human, mm-hmm. until they got older. Pregnancy was viewed as a disease in some ways. Really, really, some of those stories were pretty stark. You want to talk a little bit about anything that jumps to mind about particular societies or in that regard?
Let's go back to your point about the speech, because I can speak to that. Yeah. relatively little. This is fairly widely studied. Some in-depth studies, but mostly those anthropologists who paid attention to children or observing parent-child interaction have noted consistently that relatively little speech is directed to children, towards children. And in particular, and that it's usually very simple, short commands, directives, maybe warnings, stand back, you know, just something to bring the child up sharply. But really very, very different from our, not only our running commentary to children, even from babies, baby talk, mother ease, and so on, from the crib. We're throwing language at the kids. And long before a child can actually speak, we're treating them as if they could. And so we were talking to them in complete sentences. we are imagining what they might say in return. And vocal, you know, we give both our part of the conversation and their part of the conversation as well. Virtually none of that happens outside weird culture. You ask what weird is. Weird is Western, educated, etc., etc. And it, you can think of that notion, that theory, as analogous to my neontocracy, gerontocracy model, in the sense that I wanted to make a point with that our neontocracy is really quite unique. And just as they do with with a weird society. But there have been studies in the way of language and child language. There have been studies more recently that have paid attention to the amount of speech that children overhear. And so when you ask the question about just simply language input, okay,
right.
So we know that in weird society, children get an enormous amount of language input of a certain kind. But in, let's say, the village setting, they're not getting so much direct language input. They're not included in conversations generally, but they're free to eavesdrop. And you can imagine village life is much more public than it is than ours. It's much more public. I mean, people are living in accommodations which are generally quite open, and there much of the communal life is taking place out of doors or in open workshops, open air settings, on the farm, in the garden, foraging in the forest with a group of people. Those are all settings in which there are a bunch of people of different ages, and kids are privy to all that speech that's going on. So they're eavesdropping, and that's acceptable and even encouraged. So children aren't allowed to sort of isolate or themselves or play by themselves. They're expected to be actively listening, active listeners. So yeah, that would be one example of a big difference. With that research on overhearing and eavesdropping, the argument that the sociolinguists are making, the language acquisition people are making, is that really they're being more than adequately socialized in language. So there are no deficits in their language in the context of their language use in a village setting. Now, that doesn't speak to the issue of, well, what does this mean in terms of their schooling or their academic preparation or those issues? That's a different question.
Right.
I mean, what the research that you referred to basically was making an argument that language was scalable in a way, unidimensional. So you get a lot of vocabulary thrown at you, you'll do all this good stuff. You get very little vocabulary thrown at you, you'll be handicapped. You can say that only if you heavily contextualize it and say, well, okay, all that is true for weird society. As soon as you leave weird society, that whole model breaks down.
Interesting. Yeah, so within our Western society. And you talk a lot about in the book about the eavesdropping. I find that really interesting, and how these societies, they also don't really candy coat anything. They're not trying to edit necessarily for the children.
Exactly. Yep.
Yeah. And that, I actually had just written something about that. This kind of jumps a little ahead, but you talked about some of that where There's no, let's see if I can find the actual thing. He says, in the village, there is no lens through which culture is distorted on its way to the child's brain, right? But nowadays, with so much electronic media, there's an immense amount of distortion, I guess you would say. But electronic media represent the window our children have on society and history is through a glass darkly. and I really like that. I don't know, how concerned are you with all this electronic media and children?
Well, it's the electronic media is part of a larger issue, where children's interaction with the world at large is mediated. So in other words, it's filtered. Filtered by parents who are in effect serving as a screen, as a sensor, as a teacher. They're taking the world at large, they're cutting it up into, sanding off the rough edges, cutting up into bite-sized pieces. They're making sure there are warning labels attached. So essentially, they're mediating the children's experiences with the world, and then screens, the mediation of video games and social media and so on, is just one further extension of that. So we were already headed down that road big time before we had computers,
right.
Personal computers and iPhones and so on.
Yeah, it's quite something to contend with, you know, as a parent and as a educator. If I can, I kind of want to step back because the thing that struck me, I think if I brought anything out of your book that I would like to share with my parents, is that, well, our society and the way we view children and raise children is very much an outlier. And before this pandemic, every Friday I would train parents, and not so much on parenting, but on how they can incorporate a language-rich environment into their lives, blah, blah, blah. But what I saw consistently is parents who have an extreme amount of guilt and are constantly worried that they're doing things wrong and feel the need to, that they have to act, they need to consult with experts, and they need things and books and things to be a better parent. And
checklists on the refrigerator.
Say that again?
Checklists on the refrigerator.
Right. Yeah. So if I got anything out of your book, it's that, I don't know. I don't think that, it's a shame that we're feeling this way, because somewhere along the line, and you talk about in your book, really kind of in the 1830s or around about, I don't know if that's the exact time, when we went from trusting our instincts and learning to parent through observation to needing to talk to physicians and blah, blah, blah. Can you talk a little bit about that happening and how it happened?
Yes. It came about through the confluence of a number of really very welcome social trends. Number one, a rapid growth of the middle class. Okay, and the middle class, what's interesting about the middle class is that they don't have servants, or at least they don't have a house full of servants. Okay, so in the upper class, children are living a fairly privileged existence, but servants are taking care of them. They have in a wealthy home, a child will be born, it will have a wet nurse, then it will have a nurse, then it will have a governess, and then it will have a tutor. So its, quote, education and care will not be done by its own, by the parents. So that's not, just not part of the culture. Okay, it's considered, you know, raising children was not considered a pleasure, something that to enjoy, something to indulge in. Hard, far from it. They were considered to be noisy, dirty, bad. Their speech was inarticulate. They were really not very pleasant companions to have around. With the growth of the middle class, they could afford to have fewer children. They could afford to indulge their children, but they couldn't necessarily afford a house full of servants. So essentially, they're the first anxious parents, the first first parents who are really focused on the child and their development as an individual, rather than on developing them as laborers, as farm hands or what have you. And so there really isn't any precedent. The family sizes are smaller. This is part of what's called the demographic transition. Again, it's largely driven by improved economic situation, lowering the infant mortality rate. Finally, and you know, towards the middle late 19th century, it starts to fall significantly, which means that parents don't need to just keep breeding ad infinitum. They can rely upon the possibility that any children they have will remain alive. And so families shrink in size. That means that you don't have older siblings to kind of look after the kids. So increasingly, you've got these kids that are not considered just future workers. You've got these kids that have become sentimentalized. They've become part of the accoutrements of an improved lifestyle. I mean, to be middle class means to have a nice home, nice furnishings, regular income, economic security, good health. But it also implies that you have children and it's a pleasure. You enjoy them,
right?
And so those are the first sort of anxious parents who were breaking new ground, trying to accomplish something, create a society, which in effect they had to invent. Family life in that Victorian era had to be, middle-class family life had to kind of be invented from scratch, so to speak. So that was a very critical period. That was just, as a matter of fact, what I'm writing about today.
Huh. And so because things were getting easier, would you say that allowed? Where? How does the physician fit in? Like, why is it that we started?
Well, the physician, yes. Well, it's it's a very gradual process, a very widespread process. In effect, the hegemony of organized medicine, not just children's medicine, children's care and so on, but it was much broader than that. And you had the dramatic sort of elevation of the status. I mean, you know, from just popular history, the barber surgeon, for example, you would the same guy that cut your hair could be operating on you. The term sawbones, for example. So there was one branch of the medical profession whose job it was to treat and broken limbs or amputate in many cases. So the overall, there's a dramatic shift in the status of an improvement in hospitalization, medical schools, an improvement in medical schools, and pediatric medicine emerged. Okay, so that became a separate specialty. For a long time, children's medicine was just sort of rolled into maternity, women's medicine. You know, there was really children weren't seen as having it being a special medical category until about the beginnings, middle of the Victorian era. And things like, you know, as the dropping off of midwifery. So the midwife was considered no longer adequate. And it was quite a lot of controversy about that, as you can imagine. And doctors actually succeeded in effect, making it illegal to be a midwife or to act as a midwife independent of a doctor. So a doctor could maybe employ a midwife as an assistant, so to speak, but doctors essentially, and this was economics, they just wanted to drum up business. So they're essentially, they're continually ratcheting up the fear factor. And to be fair, there were medical breakthroughs that did legitimately enhance the medical reputation. You know, notions like hygiene, improved hygiene, operating conditions, and so on, getting rid of things like bleeding patients. There were dramatic improvements. As I mentioned earlier, the drop in mortality rates for children. All of those things enhanced the status of the doctor, and again, for pecuniary reasons, they're sort of grabbing more and more and more of the pie, and working to change, improve their legal status as well, and undermine the legal status of people like midwives.
Hmm. Yeah, I started reading your book and this transition and thinking about parenting, I started to wonder, you know, how much of this was economic. I mean, do you feel like that was one of the bigger driving forces, or if not the biggest?
I wouldn't go that far, but it's certainly there. Absolutely.
Okay. Yeah. So that's the point I want to drive home, is that there are so many cultures now today and throughout history where it wasn't viewed as the parents had to do all of the educating and be involved at every step of the way. I don't think it's natural. Based on your findings, it's not natural. And when things aren't natural, you suffer from anxiety, and you know, nothing.
Well, you're getting at something interesting here, and that is that it'd be a worthwhile intellectual exercise to try to parse out how much of these changes were, in effect, driven by circumstances beyond. Outside of parenting itself, such as the economic factors. Shrinking family size meant that you don't have older siblings to care for your children, so that increases the burden on mothers. Women working, economic factor. Here's another economic factor. Women working suggests that fathers need to step up and do more of the parenting. So, I mean, I think there are some sort of objective, if you will, forces at work over a long period of history that have had a tendency to raise the bar for parents, that it's a harder job, it's a more complex job than it has been in the past. But at the same time, the other half of that, the other side of that is, there is the mythology, if you will, that's grown up around child rearing and child care. Mythology such as the zero to three phenomenon. So this is the whole line of research that you're aware of that really stresses how important it is to stimulate the baby's brain from an early, early age. It's treated as imperative because if you don't do it, it's too late. You lose the child forever. That is about 50% myth, 50% fact. Okay, about 50% of it is hype. Is absolutely overhyped, okay? Overhyped. Essentially what you have, this is happening increasingly, especially in child psychology. Essentially you have somebody publishes a pretty good study that shows positive effects of doing X or Y or Z, and then 16 books come out and magazine articles and blog posting that say, this is it. This is it. You want to be a success. You want your children to be successful. This is what you got to do. And so, so it's like this megaphone effect. It's little study, little insignificant, small scale study is done. Appeals to the masses. Everybody picks up on it and blasts it out there. And parents scramble to add yet another criterion to self-judge themselves about their parenting skill.
Absolutely, and especially during that time period, and for sure I've heard that and even talked about the importance of birth to three. But when you are a parent raising that young child, I mean, it's hard just to stay awake during the day, sometimes. And to add that added stress of, am I saying enough words during the day? And all these things really, it just does a number on, I think, the mental well-being of parenting.
Yeah, this is central. This is so critical that I want to be able to say to parents unequivocally, this is something you don't have to worry about. Your normal level of speech that you would use just as an adult with other family members on the telephone, casually with your child, that just, you do not have to ratchet it up. You do not have to crank it up at all. You do not have to create the special speech lessons, language, vocabulary lessons. You do not have to teach your children about objects, and teach them about textures and colors and all this stuff. I mean, to keep them entertained, what's wrong with picture books with colors in them and stuff? And maybe to put them to bed at night, it helps to read them a little book about colors and numbers and stuff. Sure, great. But that you have to set aside time every day for a lesson, and if you don't, consequences will be dire. That is insane. It is absolutely insane.
Yeah. That's what I, more than anything, would like to communicate to parents, is that that's just the way that our brain is designed. And there's different theories about language acquisition and whatnot, but kids have super sponge brains, and the normal amount of talking throughout the day, they will acquire it.
That's right. That's right. Absolutely. And they may reach some sort of clinical cutoff, which you would know much more about than I do, but they may reach some sort of critical, truly, truly critical stage or bar that if they don't get over it, that's cause for call in the therapist,
Sure.
But let's be real conservative about where we put that bar.
Yeah. And and it goes to a little bit, you talking about the cultures where that parents don't necessarily talk to them directly that much, but they're still hearing a lot of language with all their eavesdropping and, they still grow up being competent in language, within their society. So that's what, especially during this time, during the pandemic, where parents are home with their kids more, and I know there's a lot of guilt of, well, I should be doing this this more with them and that. I do want to drive home that point. As long as you're talking normally with your children, that it's working. Let's see, I want to talk a little bit to, you talked a little bit about the neontocracy and gerontocracy. Is really kind of the United States and maybe, I don't know, Europe is, it's relatively new. So just for the listeners, the neontocracy is where children are at the top of the pyramid, right? And older people are down at the bottom.
Right.
And other cultures are reversed, right?
Right. Neontocracy generally really quite rare historically, cross-culturally. And obviously societies in between. So it's more of a continuum than a hard and fast distinction. But that's changing now. So the whole world has becomes wealthier and what more westernized. I mean, essentially the more and more of the world will be described as weird. Actually, it's not even limited to Western societies at all, because East Asia is becoming more and more like the West, certainly in terms of their child-rearing practices and
interesting.
What their objectives are for their children, schooling and so on.
It's really interesting. I think that pendulums swing, right? And
right.
I certainly there was need, I think, when children were seen and not heard, to give them more focus and love and that sort of thing. But then, so the pendulum was over here. Now it's swung kind of too far the other way, where we end up with, a lot of spoiled kids, to be honest. do you feel like those will merge one day?
I don't, it's a, oh boy, my crystal ball is not that clear. I don't see any signs of slowing down. For instance, just happened to come across an item inside higher education, reporting of a study which I've set aside to read later. But recording a study, small-scale study, talking about the relationship between looking at children and their well-being as a function of maternal stress. Okay, so we need a really vigorous research program to see what the effect is of stress, and if mothers particularly are stressing about their parenting, then this is not helpful to children. So essentially the direction, we talk about a pendulum, we talk about movement. So if we follow this trend, pretty good data to suggest that even as the number of children falls, we have fewer children, and even as we have more sort of child aids of various kinds, furniture specially designed for children, car seats, all this sort of special gear, which presumably should be labor-saving, even as we add all of those to the typical baggage of a home, the amount of the clock time, the amount of actual time that a parent, mothers particularly, spend interacting with their children or caring for their children, then it's blurred, that amount of time keeps going up and up and up. And so looking at that trend, then you have to ask yourself, well, is there increased maternal anxiety associated with that movement, with that inexorable increase in are mothers more anxious? And if so, can we demonstrate some negative effects on the children And if that, you know, essentially beat that drum loud enough, get out the megaphone and say, look, guys, you're not in the long run helping your kids by stressing out about this, by trying to be perfect, by trying to make them perfect. Not good. Backfire in the end. Anxiety medication, depression, antidepressants for your eighth graders is coming up in your future. You're going to have your college graduates living in the basement, and when they're 28, you know what I mean? So, I mean, I could make a case. I could go on the road like some evangelist, traveling evangelist, or snake oil salesman. I could go on the road with this, you see. Not that I have any desire to do so, but, I mean, you could build a case that would – at least metaphorically would try to stop the pendulum, stop that movement in that direction and center it.
Yeah. Sure.
You want to do that? You want to take on a crusade, Corey?
Well, you know, in some ways I would, you know, because it does break my heart to see sometimes, yeah. Because somewhere along the line, these mothers increasingly are just feeling like they're not adequate, and that they're not doing a good enough job. And that's why I feel like the perspective that your books bring is so important, because it does show that, that, you know, you don't have to be so on the ball all the time. I'm not saying ignore your children. You had a really great, what was the name of your blog?
Benign Neglect.
Benign Neglect, yes. I love that. Because they do need to, these life children life do life need to not be hovered over and right. Be allowed to play and explore. And it's so, so, so beneficial. And so even though you might feel guilty that your child is sitting around being bored, it's not a bad thing. It may even be a good thing. That's really kind of hits home to the point of why I wanted to bring some of your research to our listeners, because the science, the history shows that the children will be fine. Yeah. You talk a little about your backstory when you were young. It sounds like you were kind of, you knew you were loved and you had wonderful dinner time with your parents, but you had a lot of time by yourself. And
right. Yeah, there was no concern. Both my parents really profoundly believed in letting me control 90% of my life. The other 10% they made a claim on. but it was, you know, they just simply didn't expect to act as a parent every day, all day. You know, that was the actual, I mean, going, speaking to this research that I told you earlier, was mentioned earlier just a few minutes ago about measured clock time, how much time parents spend parenting. That number is increasing, increasing, increasing all the time. But I look at my own childhood, and I was in no way unique. The attitude in the 1950s certainly was that basically as soon as children are weaned and mobile and in effect pool safe or whatever, then you're finished with parenting pretty much. If they have measles, okay, you got to step up. If they, you know, polio, you got to step up. But other than that, parenting, the job is done. The school takes over, teachers. But even there, the attitude wasn't to helicopter and overlook the teacher. That's another vast, the huge change that's occurred, where parents no longer defer to the teacher.
Oh,
parents take on the responsibility now of saying, well, I can't just let the child's education in the hands of the school, in the hands of the teachers, I've got to supervise them too. It's not just my behavior I have to monitor and make sure I'm doing things correctly. I've got to oversee the teaching, the teachers, and the school, and peers. Parents today don't just let the kids play with anybody in the neighborhood. I mean, I played with whoever was available in the neighborhood. There was never any question of well, is that child going to be a good influence? Now, though, the parent has the responsibility. You can't just randomly let your kids play with who's ever in the neighborhood. You have to create play dates. You have to create extracurricular social gatherings so that your children rub elbows with the right kinds of peers who have good attitudes, who have, you know. That's why organized sports are so important now. Is put your children in with the right peers, have a good positive influence. You're all going to go to Harvard together.
Yeah, you know, it sounds exhausting, doesn't it?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and you know, to your point, all this extra work and worry that we put in.
It's a squirrel cage, really, because you can, you know, how do you ultimately say, okay, I've made it. I'm doing an adequate job now. I know I'm confident that I can just continue on course here. I don't need to read any more guides. I don't need to stress anymore. I've got it all figured out. The kid is 4 years old, and I've been refining my parenting up to this point. That never happens. There's never any reprieve. And with this failure to launch thing, this kid's returning to the nest. The parenting is like on your deathbed. You finally get to say, okay, you're on your own now. I can't help you anymore.
Yeah. Yeah. And I kind of wish I'd brought up that failure to launch thing earlier, but that is happening on a much, much grander scale with kids, despite the, you know, intense parenting. You know, I won't keep you much longer, but I hope that people will dive in to your books, because it does provide such wonderful insight to, you know, we as humans, we have instincts, and it's easy to want to kind of look at, there's so much available at our fingertips to make you start feeling like you're not doing a good enough job, but kids are very resilient. They need love. They do need to be spoken to. But beyond that, they're fascinating creatures that if you let them spread their wings themselves.
Let them surprise you. Let them surprise you.
Yeah, I love that. I think, let your kids surprise you. That's a good way to end things up. I have so many other questions for you, but maybe we can chat again some other time. Oh, you just released a new book, Child Helpers.
Yeah. Child Helpers, right.
You want to talk a little bit about that and then?
Well, that it was an unusual project for me, in the sense that mostly what I do is I bring an anthropological perspective on some aspect of child rearing, child development. And often what I bring from anthropology can be said in contrast to what contemporary psychology says about the same phenomena, such as the language, the vocabulary issue, the speech input issue. Very different view from anthropology. In this case of child helpers, I found a very nice complementarity between research in lab psych, which a robust series of studies carried out over the last 10, 12 years that shows that from about the age of 14 months, all children, all weird children anyway, volunteer to help out. They volunteer to help with all sorts of tasks that adults are doing. And they do this regularly. They do this without being prompted. They do this without being taught. They do it. You can put try to entice them away from helping by giving them cool toys to play with, obstacles that get around the obstacles. I've seen a few videos of this in action in these lab settings, and the kids are just amazing. You know, you see this little kid, an adult trying to push some cart that's a little heavy, and you see this little kid with a droopy diaper pushing on the cart, you know. I mean, just charming, just really, really cute. Well, in the anthropological literature, you get the same thing. I mean, it's obviously a different research methodology, a different, a much broader window on the child's behavior, and you see them integrating with and playing with knives and doing things we would never let them do. But so they have so much more freedom in the village setting. They're actually able to be helpful with whatever's going on. But then I also had to sort of report the rather depressing news that in weird society, we generally rebuff our toddler helpers because it's actually probably a little more work for us to incorporate them in the task than mothers will say, oh yeah, I do all the laundry and clean up and so on when they're having their nap. So, you know, essentially that's fine. And I can understand the sentiment that would say, look, I don't need the child to be messing all this up, make more work for me. I can understand that assessment. But then what happens, of course, is that the motivation to be helpful is extinguished. And this is a well-known cornerstone of human psychology, is that if a behavior is not rewarded, then it will extinguish. And so what happens in our society is that at about 7 or 8, parents start thinking, you know, I could use some help here. I mean, it would be nice if you clean up your own bedroom, or at least put your dirty clothes in the hamper in the laundry room here. And suddenly it's a tug of war. The kids have been no longer have that drive to be helpful, and you can't get it back. Generally, I mean, you have to pay them an allowance. You have to bargain with them, give them more screen time. It's a total turnaround from that 14-month-old who just is helping no matter what the circumstances are. Who's just eager to help, tireless. You know, it's going to put all this little energy into helping. Take out the garbage or whatever. Whereas in the village situation that anthropologists typically see, there's this smooth transition at every age level where the child is helping more, is getting more responsibility, more independent in terms of a six-year-old can take care of a little flock of goats, no problem. A seven-year-old can go weed the garden, no problem. An eight-year-old can cook dinner for the whole family, no problem. An eight-year-old boy can go out and catch small game, mammals, birds for the family stew pot. All of this is just normal and natural and as part of their growing up. Then we get to the teenage years, later teenage years, and we've got kids who have a total sense of entitlement, have a total sense of entitlement, that they don't have to pay back, that they don't have to share the burdens of family maintenance, home maintenance. Their needs are to be taken care of. Their needs are paramount. Remember, the neontocracy. And so they've failed to develop a sense of responsibility, a sense of being responsible for someone other than themselves, or even being responsible for themselves, for their own needs, and so on. And that's what the book, that's what this little book, new book, is about.
Wow. Yeah. I think just about any parent in our weird society can relate to exactly what you're saying, because it is, they do have that natural drive to help, but it kind of speaks to the downsides of our fast-paced society where we kind of push that away. And so you do see, I imagine throughout the book, you do show that pushing it away eventually kills that drive?
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Right. Wow. It kills. And it's very hard to get it back. And now informally, I've talked to a lot of parents who somehow intuitively, instinctively understand the need to get those little kids engaged. So since the book came out, I've had a lot of conversations. Well, not so many since coronavirus came out, but I've had conversations with parents who talk about how they go to actually some extra pains to make sure that the little ones are included in the work aspect of family activities and so on. And maybe they structure their interaction with their children, family time and so on, in ways to highlight or to frame the younger ones having an opportunity to be helpful and make a contribution.
Yeah, and so to your parents out there, it's worth doing, because then when they're 8, they'll cook you dinner, right?
Right.
It'd be so much nicer. I can't wait to read that book. I really am excited to do so. But thank you so much for your time.
My pleasure.
Like I said, as we go on, I might pick your brain more if you don't mind, because it's really...
Oh, it's these conversations are very stimulating.
Good. Yeah, you know, you go in your book, you say, you know, your work is about parents and children, not a prescription for how to do a better job as raising children. But having said that, as an educator and a parent reading your work, it certainly shines a lot of light on what works and what doesn't. So thank you for your work. It's good stuff.
Okay.
All right. Well, thank you. And I'll be in touch.
Thank you very much. Bye.
All right. Thank you. Bye.